funeral, and this is the wife of Dean Braxton, who was a minister, and he went in to have a surgery done. I believe it was gallstones or something, and have them blasted, and they did it. They screwed up, and it went septic, got into his bloodstream, and his heart stopped for an hour and 45 minutes. And if you look on 700 Club, there's on YouTube, you can find other videos. He was on there, and they had the doctors on there even validating that, yes, he was dead for an hour and 45 minutes. And while he was dead, he had a very interesting visit with our Lord Jesus Christ. This is Dean Braxton's wife telling about her side of what happened when he went to the hospital.
The DVD here said to me that we need to put a PICC line in Dean, or a central line, which is, you know, a port, for some of you that don't know, and they draw blood, they can draw blood from it or something too. And during that time, I left the room, waited in the waiting area, and then when I got back into the room, Dean was barely breathing. He was, and then I looked at the critical care doctor and I said, what happened to my husband? And he says, well, we reached a blockage, and trying to put it here, you know, they attempted here three times and put it in his chest. And then at that time, he says, we reached a blockage, but he says, and this is what he said, we need to intubate your husband right away or else he could die. That was it. I was like, what? So I had to left, I left the room. And you know, believe it or not, so when I left the room, because they had to, you know, put the tube down his throat, put him on a breathing machine, all that stuff. We live about 5 minutes from the hospital, so I thought, well, I'll just go home, and I'll pick up some things and come back and stay, because I'll just plan to stay with them overnight. And lo and behold, no more than two blocks down the road, the actual kidney specialist himself called me up and said, Marilyn, your husband just coded, his heart stopped, and they're doing CPR on him right now as we speak. So that gave me another what? And then I hung up the phone, and then I called my son and daughter. My son was in Dallas, Texas at Christ for the Nations Bible College. I have a daughter who was in Northwestern University in Chicago. So I really had nobody home with me, but you know, and because all the children were gone. And believe it or not, I did not turn the car back around and just go straight to the hospital. I kept going home, and I was just calling up friends and family and telling them to pray and intercede. And I had a friend who said, I'm on my way to the hospital. I mean, I'm on my way to the hospital, but I'll stop by and pick you up so you can just leave the car at home. So when she picked me up, a total of us were in the waiting area. And a total of nine of us were in the waiting area, and we just began to pray, and we just prayed, and we thanked God, not knowing, because they were still working on Dean. And when the doctor came in, he said, you know, things were really touch and go. He said, I really don't even know why all this has happened, but he says, all I can say to you all is just keep up the prayers, because I won't know anymore until in the morning. And, you know, we prayed and we thanked God. And then I sang. I just said, my soul magnifies the Lord. My heart joys in God, my Savior. For he lifts the lowly. And he's done great things for me. I will sing praise in it.
That was Dean Braxton's wife telling you what happened from her perspective. They didn't even tell him that they didn't find out until later that he was actually, his heart had stopped for a full hour and 45 minutes. He said during the speech, this was taken today at a house church in Beaverton that I attended. And I just got a little bit of video because the woman behind me didn't like me blocking the light of my phone. But they said that the doctors were initially afraid. They went in and had him tested to find out what happened, because they wanted to be able to repeat that. And but they didn't want to really come too clean with them. And they learned a lot of the details, apparently, on the 700 Club when the doctors were on the show, because they didn't want to tell them because they didn't want to get sued, right? So anyway, here is the guy who was dead for an hour and 45 minutes and visited with our Lord Jesus Christ. A second, get that big screen. There you go.
And Jesus is. Yeah. But you must filter what you experience through the Word of God. Yeah. Do you hear what I just said?
Yes.
A lot of times people come back or they say something and you wonder, where is that in the Word? And I've heard people say, well, it's not in there. And I say, wait a minute. Until you can tell me everything in there, you can't say that.
That's right. Yeah.
Do you hear what I just said?
That's right.
A lot of people say, oh, God does all kinds of things outside of His Word. He probably does. But until you know everything in there, you can't say that.
That's right.
There were many things that I experienced when I was with the Father and Jesus, I would have told you was not in the Word of God. Guess what? It's in there.
Yes.
It's in there. Okay.
Hallelujah.
And so when I start off, I read this one scripture, and I can read others. You know, the other day I did one around Lift Jesus Up, and it was, wow. That's all I can say is wow. You know? But the one he has me go back to over and over and over is in John, the 14th chapter, 1 through 6. Now, let me say something to you. These verses are very important. When I was in Singapore a few years ago, in Singapore, they have a law, and this is the law. You cannot say that Jesus Christ is the only way. He is a way, but not the only way. Do you hear what I just said? And here I am in Singapore. And what scripture do I bring up? John 14, 1 through 6. Over and over and over and over again. Because when I got there, Jesus looked at me, saw himself on the inside of me, and I was in.
Amen.
Did you hear what I just said? Mm-hmm. He didn't see Buddha. He didn't see Muhammad. He didn't see anybody else inside of me. Who he saw inside of me was himself. Amen. And because he saw himself on the inside of me, I was in. Is that good news? Is that good news?
Yes.
So there is no other way but Jesus Christ. So in John 14, 1 through 6, it says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. This is Jesus Christ talking. Really, I always tell people what he's saying is, trust me. And you say, what does he mean? What do you mean by that? See, everybody on this planet, someday is going to have to leave their body, which we call death. Mm-hmm. The bottom line is, where are you going to go?
That's right.
Amen. Amen.
You know, one of the advantages I have is because I was born again, knew Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, have the Holy Spirit residing on the inside of me forever. When I left my body, I went where Jesus said we go.
Amen.
Wow. I wish you could have heard his whole testimony. Tacoma, Washington, and hear his whole story. It is amazing. And one of the things he said is he doesn't tell you things that he saw while he was there unless you ask. And that's what God had led him to respond with, because hubris doesn't, you know, pride goeth before the fall, that whole thing. But just really loves the Lord. And I know I don't talk about religion too terribly much. I had one show where I did a lot, but I must like to think I'm a strong Christian, and I hope I'll be as fortunate as Dean was and be with the Lord. Near-death experiences are fascinating. If you research them, as I've done in several cases, then you'll see that the Lord really, I mean, he's there for us. And if you don't, if you turn away from him, he's not going to be there. And eternity's, like he says this morning, Dean said, it's a long time. Eternity, you're going to be up there or down there a lot longer than you're going to be here on the earth. So, you know, get right with the Lord. That would be what I'd have to say about it. A friend of mine from high school, I've talked about him on the show before, Bob Woodruff. You may have seen this in the news. I believe it was somewhere, I want to say 2006 or something. He had just made it to the pinnacle of his career and gotten the job of being a co-anchor, head anchor on the ABC Nightly News. And the way it was set up is Maria Vargas, I think was the other woman's name, the other co. She was in the studio and he get to go out on the field because he liked to go out and he liked to go visit the troops. He was in bed in the Iraq War. And so he was in Iraq. And oddly enough, he had just seen my ex-husband who was in Israel before he left. They were at the same hotel, but my ex didn't say hello to him. But anyway, so he was in Iraq, and he was in the tank, and he was doing a stand-up, and he's got the cameraman videotaping him, and he gets hit with an IED. And he and his wife wrote a book called In an Instant. He was induced, and they took off his skull cap, it was shattered, and they induced a coma. For 3 months he was in a coma, and his brain was able to swell and not too terribly much damage, but he still had to learn English again. He had his own children teaching him that. So it was a miraculous story. But when he first got hit, he had a near-death experience. He's apparently, I have to read the book again because it's in the book. He felt this warm, welcoming light, and it was fabulous. And he didn't want to come back. And the next thing he knew, he could see himself in the tank, I think, or he just woke up and he saw the cameraman bloody, and then he was out. And then 3 months later, his wife came back from working out and going swimming and said, "Hi, where have you been?" or something. And he's reporting now and has been reporting for many years now. But some mutual friends of ours went to visit him while he was still recuperating in his home on the East Coast. And they said that he had a pastor or priest or minister there with him. And I know he was not a real strong Christian at the time, but you know, God works in mysterious ways, and he works in a way that you just have to open your eyes and see the people that he places in your path, and the way that he makes things happen. How can you not believe in God? And so that was another near-death experience. Another a relative of my ex-husband's, she went into the hospital, and her twin brother, she's an elderly woman, and her twin brother had passed on, and her sister had passed on. And while when we went over to visit her after she got out of the hospital, and she said, "I had this dream," which I think was a near-death experience, and it sounds a lot like it. She said it was like fuzz, like the fuzz on a you know, when the olden days when you turn the channel, there would be no channel there, that fuzz. And inside it was her sister, that died, and her twin brother. And she started to tear up and almost started to cry while she was telling us the story. And she said, "They were scolding me and telling me I can't come, but I wanted to come so badly. I wanted to come." And because it's a lot better up there. That's what Dean says too. He says it stinks when you get down here after you've been up there. So she had what I think is a near-death experience. Maybe you have know somebody who might have had a near-death experience, but God's having to reveal himself to us because the other side, the evil devil, whatever you want to call it, that side is really making inroads here on planet Earth.
As a update, after I created this show, we have volunteers that would volunteer on everyone's access shows. And that night, and that night alone, this very nice woman who's owns the Catholic bookstore came up to me after the show and said, "I had a near-death experience." And I said, "You did?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "Well, didn't you want to stay? I mean, most people want to stay. Did you see Jesus? What happened?" And she said, "No, I saw the Virgin Mary." And she looked at me, and I can't tell you, but looking in her eyes, it was as though she almost regretted her decision. But she said, "You know, I just given birth to my first child, and I just gotten married, and well, I felt like I should stay." So I think that's an amazing another way that God works. Why did that woman, Beverly, decide to show up and volunteer on that night of all the nights that she could have volunteered on my television show, and has never volunteered and did never volunteer again after that?